If you don't mind, I want to talk to you about, again, missional community. Did anybody ever hear that word missional community before? Besides our regular missional community. It means we have a mission and we live in a community. Right? Everybody say that. We have a mission.
We have a mission.
And we live in a community.
We live in a community.
And God wants us to reach our community for the kingdom of God. That's our job. That's our responsibility. Matter of fact, I've been talking to our church for a while, for you that are guests today, that this is not the church. This building, even though I love it and we're here, this is not the church. Okay, everybody say, this is not the church. This is not the church. You are the church. Jesus said to Peter, upon this rock, the truth is that he's going to build his church. It wasn't on a building or a location. It was in our hearts. Amen? And he knew in his heart that Jesus Christ was the Son of God, and that's the message. Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Every religion that doesn't say that is not of God. So how do you know a true religion? Is you know that those that acknowledge that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, it's deep. It's really deep, but it's very simplistic. That you would just bow our hearts. What are we bowing to? Are we bowing to an organization? Are we bowing to a church location? Or what are we bowing to? When you're in your prayer closet, or those that have them, and you kneel down, or you sit down, or lay down, or whatever you do, you're there because you want to go into the presence of God. God wants to take us from our normal life in the outer courts and bring us right into the holies of holies so we can be in his presence. He wants us to be there, talking with him, communicate with him. He wants us to know him. He wants to know his power. He said, I'll pour out my spirit, as I talked about last week, on all people. It's that we talked about last week that on all flesh, men and women, I will pour out my spirit on the servants. And that word servants is bond servants. So he wants to pour out his spirit on all of you and us, you and I today. He wants to pour out his spirit on you so you can be his bond servants. And I said the reason the church is weak at best sometimes because we're just servants. Oh, I have to serve here, I have to serve there, I have to do this, I have to do that. And it goes much deeper than just servant. Because the word servant there, it interprets like a waiter. You know, you go to a restaurant, a waiter comes up, they give you your water, give you your food, they take your order, all those things. And it's more than that. God wants us to be bond servants today. And I think the reason we're not powerful as Christians in America, at least, and maybe in your countries, is because we're just serving and we're not bond servants. What's the difference? As a bond servant, I'm giving my life 100% over to Jesus. Everything I do, every action that I am, everything that I own, all of it belongs to Jesus. You ever hear that before? Huh? I'm blessed. We didn't have a car. Our truck broke down. We decided we're not going to buy a car. We said we're going to wait on God. We're not going to take out a loan to buy a car because it's so easy to just take out another loan. But it's difficult to trust God. And just a few months later, we have that little red car out there. My renters had it. Then my new renters, we just deducted a little bit off our rent for the next few months, and the car was going to be paid for. There's no money out of our pocket. So thank you, Jesus. Amen. Trusting God for everything. It's hard. It's easy to say, but it's hard to do. Same thing with missional community. I think all of us in our hearts want to share Jesus with our neighbor or our friend or our co-workers, but how many know it sometimes is a little difficult to accomplish, amen? You know, you're standing in the grocery line, you feel like the Holy Spirit wants you to say something to that person in front of you, and you know it, and you're talking to the Holy Spirit, right? You're having this conversation back and forth with the Holy Spirit. Well, I don't want to embarrass her. I don't want to embarrass him. I don't want to get embarrassed. I don't know what to really say. But I know you want me to say something. Come on, you know what I'm talking about, right? I know you want me to say something, but I don't want to say it. And you're all the way through the checkout line, you're having this conversation with the Holy Spirit. You could really have to have a conversation with that person, and who knows what could happen. What's the worst thing that can happen here in America? Huh? Say again?
They shun you.
They don't want to be around you. Yeah, I guess so. After a while, you could say that. But you know what I found out? And I'm just using my own family as an example because most of my family is not believer. I mean, let me take that back. They're believers, but they're not bond servants. They kind of acknowledge God, but they're not really, you know, They probably hadn't read their Bible. If they have one, it's in the back of their seat or their car, and it's all dusty, right? They're just kind of like, they're not denying Christ, but they're not really serving God. They kind of say, they'd be a person you talk on the street would say, yeah, my grandmother was a Christian or a Catholic or a Lutheran or something, but that's their extension of their relationship with God, just from whatever their grandmother or father or mom took them to church, or maybe a sidewalk Sunday school group came by and brought them, picked them up with their kids, or whatever, but then after they became adults, I don't even know how deep that is. I want to be a light to them. I want to show God's love to them. And through my sister's heart attack, some of you know that, and being there and praying for her out loud, and having a prayer meeting at the hospital with my family members. And when I said, let's pray, they all went like this. I said, no, let's stop. We don't need to bow our heads. We're going to learn today how to pray out loud together for our family. And I taught them how to pray out loud. That was a love and compassion and led them to pray for my sister. And it was really an awesome moment as they begin to see that we can actually talk to God like we talk to each other. And you see my younger nieces and nephews begin to understand and ask questions about that. And I thought that was really cool. So we have to be light in the world today, right? So first thing we need to do, all right? Jesus told us that we are to make disciples, go and teach them everything, right? Baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. I caught on that 3 weeks ago. So that our mission is to make disciples. So where does that come from? Why did Jesus say make disciples? And I think it comes all the way back to Genesis, where God said, I made Adam and Eve. He said, I made them, the woman and the man, in our image. And so that mandate has gone through all scripture, all the way up to the point when Jesus said, go and make disciples. Make them in not your image, because our image is not really good, but we make them in the image of Jesus. We want little Jesuses running around, if you will. We want the pattern in their lives. We want you and the people that we meet to make patterns. So can you disciple? This is a revelation for me after being a minister for all these years. This is a revelation for me. Can you make disciples of somebody that's not a believer? No? I got one no. Okay, how many no's here? Raise your hands. How many yeses? Got a few yeses? No's on this side, yes on this side. Okay, I'll stand over here with you. No, I'm just kidding. Leave me alone. I think you can. I think we can, because, and I'll tell you why. When you're making disciples, you're teaching a person to come from maybe at this point they're a non-believer. The Ingalls scale, if anybody knows anything about the Ingalls scale, it says some people are at a -5 in their belief of there isn't a God, we don't believe at all. Half of Madison like that. And then you have people that are a -4, -3, so on and so forth. 0 being maybe they acknowledge Jesus, and then 1, 2, 3, 4 as they grow in their relationship with God. But anyway, so somebody could be at a -5, but you could bring them to a -4 because your relationship with them, because you're kind to them, you love them, you're drawing them to God, but you're not saying God every other word. You're not saying Jesus every other time, but you're just being kind to them. And all of a sudden I say, why are you happy? Why do you come to work happy? I mean, I had 8 cups of coffee and I still ain't got it together, you know? But you always smiling. Why are you smiling all the time? Because there's something in me. I can't share it with you right now, but I want to share it with you. Just when you get hungry enough, I'll share it with you. You don't want to say those words, but that's what you do, right? Because you want them to come along. And pretty soon you're going to maybe a baseball game with them, bringing them over to your house for a barbecue, or whatever, so you can build a relationship with them. And then finally they will ask the question, what is up with you? Share, I know this guy. His name is Jesus. He changed my life. And you get to share the whole gospel from creation to redemption. You can share with them what God did for you, because now they're hungry now. Are you that's why Jesus said we have to be a light shining on a hillside. You ever see a light off at a distance? How many miles away can you see a light? But you think about it, you're just drawing people to Jesus. right? Because our responsibility is to draw, the Holy Spirit's responsibility is to really convict them of all their guilt and sin and blah, 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 right? We don't have to do that. All we have to do is give them the message that there's hope in the world, that the Creator God loves them even though they know in their own heart that their life is so kind of messed up. It's our job to bring light to them. So I say the number one thing that we should do before we try to win people to Jesus, this is a lost art in the church today. Number one thing is pray. How many know that that's true? Come on. Right? I was just listening to a video. The Assemblies of God is 100 years old. We're celebrating this week in Springfield, Missouri, blah, blah, blah. It's a great thing. But all the early foundation of our denomination, if you will, or we don't call it denomination, fellowship, is that it was founded on prayer out of Azusa Street, out of California. And then they prayed, the Holy Spirit came down, people were baptized in the Holy Spirit, power of God, people were being healed left and right, amazing. It's interesting too, because the church, Seymour Williams was the leader of the little mission there in Los Angeles. The church staff was all, as multicultural staff, I thought, yes, God, we're on the right track. We believe that God, because of all the different cultures that we have, and we pray together. It's so fun to listen. I come to the African church on Thursday night when they pray. It's a whole other prayer realm, right? The Spanish church on Tuesday night, if you want to come in. I don't speak Spanish, but brothers and sisters, they pray. 2 hours down the road, and they're still praying, right? Just praying, dancing, get the tambourines out. We're having a prayer meeting. That's on Tuesday night. So if you want to come for that, come on. Say Spanish, did I say Tuesday?
Yes.
Thank you, Mike. Good wife. Thursday night, and it's a great time. You come to our prayer meeting, we have just a few people here, but listen, we pray. We seek God, because we know the only difference I can make in this city is prayer. Amen? And so if you want to reach your friends and neighbors and loved ones to Jesus, I believe it has to start with prayer. Amen? Have a prayer meeting. Think about it in Acts chapter 1. Jesus told the disciples, go into Jerusalem, tarry there until you've been endued with power. And they were in the upper room, which was around the temple area. They were in a room, had their Passover meal, and they were praying, right? And then the Spirit of God came down. They were praying, they were praising, because they just saw Jesus walk through the wall, ate dinner with them, right? It's amazing. He was dead. They saw him die. They saw him put in a grave. They saw the grave empty. And then now he told them, gave them this instruction, go tarry there because I'm going to do you with power. And what happened? As they were worshiping and as they were thanking God, listen, I think one of the most important prayers to pray is thanksgiving. I don't know what to pray, but I'm just going to thank you, God, for changing my life. I'm going to thank you for all these situations. I believe that my faith will increase because you have put this on me. So I'm going to believe you, God, through this trial and tribulation. I don't care what the world says. I don't care what my bank account says. I believe that you can help me overcome this situation right now, right? How many have faith to believe that?
Amen.
Come on. How many
Amen.
Have faith to believe that?
Amen.
We can do that thing. We can have faith to overcome any situation that word that's given us because the Lord does it. So they're in this upper room, they're praying, and all of a sudden, just like the prophet Joel said, prophesied, then the Spirit of God came on them like tongues of fire.
Yes.
Was it fire that sat on them?
Holy Spirit.
Yes. That's what the Word of God says. That's what you translate it out. It says fire. Fire is fire. So Lord, send fire right now in this place and let it rest on you, amen? And as they begin to thank God for what they saw, they lifted up their hands towards heaven and began to speak in another tongue. All the languages that were spoken in the city of Jerusalem at the time, all those people heard their own tongue. And they heard them praising God. They're not drunk as you suppose they are, but what they are, they're filled with the Holy Spirit just like the prophet Joel says. And the God added to their number that day, 3,000 people got saved. Or let's say it this way, 3,000 people recognize that Jesus Christ was the Son of God. Those same people that shouted, crucify him, are now praising him and glorifying him. So you want to see God move in your life? You want to see God move in this city? You want to see this house full with people for the kingdom of God? Then we need to pray together. Amen? So I'm going to invite you again Wednesday night from 6 o'clock, 7 o'clock to 8 o'clock, and sometimes go a little bit longer. That's fine. Come. And let's pray together. Amen. We're not going to change that. We're not going to do a Bible study on Wednesday night. We're not going to teach on Wednesday night. We're not going to do anything because we don't have the resources to do a lot of ministry stuff that other churches do. We're just going to pray together because we believe God is bringing a whole group of new international people to come to Madison, Wisconsin. We're going to be able to touch the life of just a few of them and hope they'll come to know Jesus like Leo did. Going to law school, international law, going back to China to do his thing for his life, try to, you know, make money, make a name for himself, and now he's confronted with a relationship with Jesus, and it's blown his mind away. And Shaw too, right? But I'm just thinking of Leo, because Leo got a call in his life. I know God's got a call on him. He's got, and now he's fighting with the fact, do I get my doctorate, and I'm a doctor in law, or do I serve Jesus? This is where he struggled. Pray for him, will you? It's amazing what God can do just because we love on people. And my heart for them is just the fact that we served in the military for so many years, and our church family was our family. So we traveled, and every time we went to a new location, the family, the church was our family. We adopted grandparents for our kids. We just, you know, did ministry. It was an amazing thing, amazing life that we lived. And now we're here, and we just feel the same way. It's the kindred spirit, the fathering, mothering kind of thing, that just, let's gather them in and love on them. And Tina just loves cooking, so she'll learn, you know, what country you're from and what your favorite meal is, and she'll look it up on the internet and figure it out, and we'll have that meal for dinner. And they just love it, right? We just love doing that stuff. So prayer is important. The other thing is that we started life groups last year, and we have just a couple. We're going to reformulate that next week. We're going to have, we're going to relook at that next week. But our life group, we should look at that as a team to reach our community for Jesus. So I know, I just want to pick on Rajiv, but Rajiv is leading a life group with the young married couples, and they have a good group. And you know, it's difficult to say, okay, we meet together to encourage each other in the Word, which they do, and they pray for one another, which is part of what we do every time we meet together, is pray for each other. But then, how do we reach out with that group to our community? And there's a variety of different ways to do that. I told Rajiv, why don't you just take your neighbor that lives next door in the apartment he lives in and invite them to the next meeting or barbecue or whatever. Amen. It doesn't have to be a major thing. We don't have to do a big event. We don't have to bounce houses and clowns and balloons and all that stuff. Let's just be real. Everybody, last week I said, everybody has to eat. So invite them to dinner. Something about, in the Word I read, something about the gift of hospitality. Everybody should practice that. Right? So what does that mean? That means, if you got to eat, let's go ahead and invite somebody and get to know them. My problem is when people come to my house, I talk too much. So I have to not talk as much, right? Tina's getting And so I have to listen to their story and their life and find out what's going on in them, because God is just concerned about that as much as you are, amen? Or we should be equally concerned. So look at your life group as a launching pad, as reaching your community. And the next one is listen to their story. When I was in Home Depot, and Rajiv, what was that man's name? Do you remember? You know, he just started, and I said, he just kind of threw up, you know, he just kind of gave us all his information about his life. It was great. And just share and listen, and I about four or five times through the conversation, I had to bite my lip just not to say something, because I want to interject how God can do that or take care of that in his life. And I was so excited that he was just sharing this, because it's like to be an example to Rajiv that this is how being a Christian, just being light in a community is. This is what happens. And it happens to me often, and I love it. So I just believe that it's important to listen to the story and then tell them the truth. Or if they tell them the truth, tell them who God is. Don't tell them about Pastor Bob. I don't really care if anybody knows about me. Don't tell them about our church family. Don't tell them about our denomination. I think that's where we messed up in Christianity. We had built the church on a business model, so we have numbers in mind. Get more people, more offering, we do more things, and that might be all true in respect, but sometimes it comes out first instead of telling them about God's love. And God created the world, and then man fell, and they sinned, but God redeemed us through his Son, Jesus. And through his blood, we're cleansed from that unrighteousness, and we're made holy through him. It's not anything that we do, because of what Christ did for us. So So God wants to redeem us or bring us back to Him in a loving relationship. That's the message of the gospel, and that's what we should teach, and that's what we should share first. Then they'll ask you, where do you go to church? Because you live in America, everybody goes to church somewhere. It's not at the local bar, at least it's at the, you know, some building somewhere. But, you know, everybody goes somewhere on a weekend. So you can invite them to that. But make that the first priority, and it'll change this, and it'll change something in you. I believe what it's changed in me is that I now have a little bit more, maybe I'm not quite there yet, but I think I have a heart change like our Father God has for people that are not His children yet. Because I want to put Him first, and I want to glorify Him. And so on Sunday morning when I come, and maybe the church isn't full, that's okay. Because I was able to share God's love with that person at Cop's Food Store, and maybe this weekend, by the Holy Spirit, will draw them to a fellowship or some group that will help nurture them. Amen? And so there's a difference in my thinking, and this is only within the last 2 years, if you will, because I know it's not about me, it's about Jesus. Right? So we change our songs at worship time. We're going to change songs. We want all our songs. We're not doing radio. My son Christopher, he's a worship leader, but he always tells me, we don't do radio songs. You know what I'm saying? The fast, fun songs on the radio. It's great. Listen to them while you're driving on the road. It's good songs. There's nothing wrong with them. But I want to sing songs here together that's going to bring us closer to Jesus. I love you, Jesus. What's the song? Oh, I Surrender All, we sang last week, right? And we sang it 100 times, I think, because I was just like in that mode of like, I haven't surrendered everything. I was talking about bond servants anyway, so it's like, I surrender my whole life to Jesus. I surrender everything. So anyway, that's for you. You don't put that on anybody that you're talking to, though, right? I want to be a reflection of Jesus so I can share the true gospel with the world around us so they'll come to know Jesus as Lord and Savior. That's what I want. Amen, and I want that for you also. And I think it's important also to do not only that you love people and share the truth with them, but that you also share as much as possible every day with somebody the love of Jesus. It will rock your world. It will change you. I was in the service, and so every morning I'd get up, as a new Christian, every morning I'd get up, because my pastor said get up early and pray before you go to work. So before I go to take a shower, before I put my uniform on, I'd go in the living room, and I would pray. And we had these old wooden, I don't know what they're called, but anyway, I had like an ottoman. I'd kneel down there, and I'd pray. And I'd ask God, would you give me somebody today to share your love with? Because that's what my pastor told me to do. So I did it. And I would pray every day fervently, God, give me somebody. So every day when I got to work, I was in a maintenance shop. So I had welders, and we had machinists, and we had rebuild people, a hydraulic shop. I had all the stuff that we worked at. So every day I'd walk down the middle of the shop, and I'd say, Holy Spirit, who am I supposed to talk to? So I'd walk down. They saw me coming. It was kind of, I was a little zealous. But anyway, so they would run. But then I would, this is in the beginning, though. And then I walk in, and the Holy Spirit said, go into the machine shop. So I go in this machine shop, talk to Eli. Eli was a machinist. Eli was making a marijuana smoking pipe on the lathe. You know what I'm talking about? A little pipe, anybody years ago? None of you guys know that stuff, right? A cellus. Okay. So not that I know how to use anything or like that or been any familiar. So not that they're identified with any of that. But anyway, so he was making these. And the guys were buying them from him, and he was using metal from the shop, blah, blah, blah. Anyway, so I was in there. Eli's wife was pregnant and had, she just had a miscarriage. And so Eli was doing all this, but trying to make extra money for his family, but he was hurting inside, and the Holy Spirit, after a long conversation, he began to share that with me. And then I was able to pray with them about that. And anyway, I was willing to share God's love with anybody at any time. And so then I got educated in religion and what to do, and I kind of got away from that. You know, I kind of studied for my credentialing, went through all my whole, you know, the courses that I need to do and all that stuff and school. And then all of a sudden I'm here and I'm realizing that I need to be back there. I need to shake off all the religious and all the junk and all the systems and all the things that just be like Jesus was in the world. Walk through the everyday life, walk through the marketplace, and, you know, cast out a demon if you need to, lay hands on the sick if you have to, but share God's love with the people around us. That's what missional community is really about. That's what missional community is all about, is loving people. And I think that we need to be faithful to that and understand that if we would do that on a regular basis, God would change your world. Amen? What about my family? Do they know Jesus? Well, most of my family doesn't, but this summer we spent a little extra time with them, maybe because my sister's heart attack, my dad came up from North Carolina. We're able to just be with them and share God's love with them. And I don't have to, matter of fact, I learned something. Can I tell myself a little bit? I have a cousin that's gay, homosexual, I don't know, whatever term we want to use today. So a nephew, right, a nephew. And so for years, he hated me because I was a pastor, you know, he thought I was judging him every time we had a family gathering. And this last Christmas, we sat on the couch together. I got sick from him, actually, didn't I? He was from Chicago, and he brought some flu with him, and everybody got sick. But anyway, that's not the point. The point was this, that we sat on the couch together, and we talked. And I said, I understand that you think I don't like you. And of course, that opened up the door. And I told him that's absolutely not true. I said, I love you just like everybody else. And I began to share some things. He says, so at the end of the conversation, we had a good conversation about his lifestyle and where he's at. And he says, well, maybe someday at the end, because it was just a light-hearted thing. He says, maybe at the end, he goes, well, maybe you can marry me and my friend. I said, probably not. But anyway, it was a good conversation. But now today, I have an open door now I can talk with them where before I did, because there was this barrier there because of my religion or way I acted or I don't know what I did, but I apologized to him because I didn't want that to be a barrier for him to come to know Jesus. And so God will open that door if we'll just be that love to the world around us. Amen? So I'm asking you, and I'm challenging you this morning, to maybe, can we show this video? And I'm going to close with this. I'll come back. I want you to watch this. This is a friend of ours who's in Iceland. And Andrew Bohan was in California. We were there. His dad was the head deacon of our church. Wonderful man of God. Truly a deacon by the word of God. And this is his son. His wife made this video. And I want to show it.
Hey! I'm in a closet. I'm a hotel. Therefore, I have no clothes. But lately, I don't know, I keep hearing this term everywhere, like, oh, he or she came out of the closet. Well, I can see why. It's cramped in there. But I've been wondering, maybe Christians are doing the same thing. Maybe we're hiding who we really are. Well, today, I declare that I am coming out of the closet. I am no longer a hidden Christian. I am a Bible-believing, Jesus-uplifting, miracle-seeing girl. I love Jesus. Tell everyone you know that I am no longer a hidden Christian. Today, maybe you need everyone around you to know who you really are. Come out and declare that you are a Christian and live abnormal.
Awesome. What do you think of that? Woo. So, Kimberly is probably, they're probably going to come here in the next few weeks. They're coming back to America for to raise funds, I guess. I'm not sure what their whole agenda is. But anyway, I saw this on Facebook. Hey, we got Facebook. And we're friends, so I get to see some of her videos are pretty funny. And so messaged her last night, and I said, hey, can I use your video? And she said yes, and then we tried to download it, it didn't work, so she uploaded it to YouTube so we could have it this morning. And she is, they're in Iceland, so they're like, it was 2:30 in the morning when I actually, she did it. She says, I'm up and I should be sleeping. Well, obviously you're up because God wanted you to be, so you guys see that. The point is, where are you in your Christian walk? So let me challenge you this morning. Come out of the closet. Amen? Come out of the closet. Come out and let people know who you are. In Iceland right now, the reference is kind of funny in one sense, because in America, people talk about coming out of the closet in the 80s. In Iceland, where she's at, they're just now coming out of the closet. 300,000 people in Iceland, 100,000 admit to being homosexual. 100,000, that's about one-third of the country. It's kind of crazy. Or maybe they're supporters, I don't know the details. But I believe that us as believers, if we would be a little more bold about who we are and realize the mission that God gave all of us is to reach the world for Him and not to hide our who we are. And I like last week I shared that, you know, you have a profession, you have an education, you have all those things. God's going to use all that. Don't look at your life and what you're accomplished as something hindering you from using God, but use what you have and your talents for the kingdom of God. And let your light shine for Him. Amen? No, that's okay. So why don't we do this? Why don't we stand up? Why don't we stand up? Why don't we stand up for Jesus? Why don't we stand up for the kingdom of God? Why don't we stand up and let God be light in our world? Amen? Let's stand up. Come here. Come on. I'm going to have Angela. I always bring this on her. She's going to get used to me. But Angela, come here. And I don't know if everyone here today is a believer, but I'm going to give you an opportunity to say yes to Jesus. Amen? And maybe even saying yes to Jesus today is maybe you could even say to yourself, I'm renewing my boldness for the kingdom of God. Maybe today I'm just going to say yes. I'm not going to have you raise your hand. I'm not going to have you come to the altar or any of that kind of stuff. But right where you're at, would you just ask God to allow your light to shine brightly for Him? Don't be afraid any longer don't be apologetic for being a Christian. Don't. Be bold. Because that's what the Word of God says. When the Holy Spirit came upon us, and all of us that are believers, the Holy Spirit is deposited in us. And they began to speak in tongues, but they also had power. It's called the word dynamite power. They had power to be witnesses. That's why the Holy Spirit came. So we could be witnesses. Not to be complacent and be satisfied our Christian or our religious obligation, but to be bold for His kingdom. Amen? That's what I believe. I pray for a church, a group of believers that are bold, Father. That Father, just like Peter walked and His shadow healed. James and John, on the way to the temple in the morning when the crippled man was laying there, they said, silver and gold have I none, but such that I have in the name of Jesus, rise up and walk. God, just like they did, God, I pray that we give You all the glory and honor, Father God. And Father, I pray for forgiveness. For where we're fearful of not doing what the Spirit of God is telling us to do. Father, embolden Your children this day to do the Great Commission. To do what You command us to do. To go and make disciples. Teaching them all things that You have taught us. And baptizing them. Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, Lord, bless Your people. Amen. And right where you're at right now, if you need to ask the Lord to forgive you for anything, just do that right now. And I'm going to have Angela come, and I want her to pray a blessing over you, a blessing and a word of encouragement so to be strong for the kingdom of God.